I'm Darrell Huckabee. I'm from Fort Lauderdale, Georgia. And I'm proud to be a Fort Lauderdale Lenten. Preacher at my church over the Methodist Church won't let me call myself a Lenthead. He thinks it might offend people. He just don't know what it's all about. I'm happy to be here with you today. I'm fresh from the Holy Land. I got back from Israel on Wednesday night, had an incredible trip. Never in my life, as I was growing up in that little mill village house in Fort Lauderdale, did I imagine that I would be able to one day walk where Jesus had walked. We saw some amazing sights, had some amazing experiences. We stood on the Mount of Olives, where Jesus wept over Jerusalem and looked down on that whole city. We stood on the Mount of the Beatitudes in the exact spot where Jesus most likely delivered the Sermon on the Mount. I think the most impressive thing to me was we sat on the rocks. You remember the time when Jesus appeared to the disciples after his resurrection. Peter had said, "I think I'm going to go fishing." And he and the other disciples went out into the boat and had a bad night, didn't catch anything. They looked up on the shore and saw a man standing on the shore who said, "Cast your nets over here." They did, caught 153 fish. And then Jesus cooked the fish for them. They had a fish fry right there on those rocks. I sat on those rocks where Jesus asked Peter three times, "Do you love me?" "Lord, you know I love you. You know everything. Feed my..." I sat on those rocks. I almost got put in jail sitting on those rocks. Because apparently they're off limits. They don't want you to sit on them. But I sat on those rocks. I went down into the pit at Caiaphas' house where they held our Lord for a few hours just before he was led to the cross to be crucified. Just an amazing journey. And the Lord willing, I hope I'll get to go back someday. And hopefully some of you maybe can make that pilgrimage as well. But I'm here today to talk to you about the risen Lord and what Christ can still do in our lives today. Would you go with me to the Lord in prayer? Heavenly Father, you are the creator of the entire universe. You are the author of life. You are the God of Abraham, the God of Moses, the God of David, the God of our Lord, and our God, the only God. Dear Lord, we thank you today for your Son, Jesus Christ, who, though he was blameless, came to live among us and to die for our sins. For that we give you thanks, praise, honor, and glory. And dear Lord, I would ask that over the next few minutes that you would empty this vessel of everything that is Darrell Huckabee and replace it with the words of our Lord, and that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing, acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength, our rock, and our redeemer. In precious name we pray. Our scripture lesson today comes from Dr. Luke's Gospel, starting in chapter 5, verses 17 through 26. I don't know what is the custom here, but if you are able, would you still please stand and join me in the reading of God's Gospel. One day, as he was teaching, Pharisees and teachers of the law, who had come from every village of Galilee and from Judea and Jerusalem, were sitting there. And the power of the Lord was present for him to heal the sick. Some men came carrying a paralytic on a mat and tried to take him into the house to lay him before Jesus. But they could not find a way to do this because of the crowd. They went up on the roof and lowered him on his mat through the tiles into the middle of the crowd, right in front of Jesus. When Jesus saw their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." Pharisees and the teachers of the law began thinking to themselves, "Who is this fellow who speaks blasphemy? Who can forgive sin but God alone?" Jesus knew what they were thinking, and he asked, Why are you thinking these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say your sins are forgiven, or to say get up and walk? With that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. He said to the paralyzed man, I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home. Immediately, he stood in front of them, took what he had been lying on, and went home praising God. And everyone was amazed and gave praise to God. They were filled with awe and said, we have seen remarkable things today. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. There are several things to look at in this particular scripture. Let's look at the very first sentence, verse 17. One day, as he was teaching. Jesus wore a lot of hats. Jesus was a lot of things. He was a teacher. They called him Rabbi. He came to die for our sins. He came to exhibit how we should live our lives. And he came to teach the people. He came to inform the people. He came to make the people aware of how they should live their lives in order to be in accordance with God's will. And that's where you want to be. That's the only way you can have perfect peace in this life. That's the only way you can have the peace which passes all understanding to live in God's will. I know. I was outside of God's will for a long time. When I was 12 years old, I was called to preach the gospel. It wasn't just a suggestion. It wasn't a thought that maybe that's what I could do. I had a clear calling from God to preach the gospel. That's what God wanted me to do in my life, and I ignored that call. Some people said, oh, you missed your calling. I didn't miss my calling. I just said no to it. I walked away from it. I ignored it. I was afraid to be obedient to God because I was afraid that he might send me places that I didn't want to go. He might have me at First Baptist Church of Conyers one morning speaking to the multitude, and I might not want to do that. Or he might not allow me to do what I wanted to do. I might have to make decisions in my life if I were a minister of the gospel according to God's will instead of mine. I said no. I was afraid. When I graduated from college at the University of Georgia, hallowed be thy name. Amen. I still knew that that was God's calling on my life. So I enrolled at the Candler School of Theology at Emory University with the intention of starting the seminary in the fall semester. And when September came and it was time for me to answer that call, I just didn't show up. I got cold feet. I don't mean I called and said, I think I've changed my mind. I think I've delayed this for a while. I just didn't show up. There were three professors on that first day of school that called my name and got no answer. I wasn't there. I wasn't a bad guy. I've lived a pretty good life. I've been a Christian. I haven't ever given up on my beliefs or my faith. I taught school for 39 years. I went all over the country speaking and teaching and making people laugh. But those weren't the things that God called me to do. God called me to preach the gospel. And so for the first 60 years of my life and my adult life, I was disobedient to God because I wasn't doing what he had called me to do. Most of you know my story, and 2 years ago at this time, I had stage 4 cancer. I still do have stage 4 cancer, but the doctors were telling me that I had 4, 5, 6 months to live, and I would lay in bed at night, and I would think, I'm going to see Jesus face to face. And he was going to ask me a question. And I had no answer to that question. When I was raised in Porterdale, you know, I was raised in a 4-room Mill Village house. We didn't even have a bathroom in our house while I was in the 5th grade. I got 4 now. five, count in fact 40. When I got to the University of Georgia, I took sociology. My professor found out that I had been raised in a mill village, and he announced to the class, Mr. Huckabee was raised in poverty in a North Georgia mill village. My professor was obviously educated far beyond his intelligence. We weren't poor in Porterdale, we just didn't have any money. There's a big difference. I had a wonderful childhood. We had the run of that village. We could be out the door as soon as it got daylight and didn't have to be home until our mom was called for supper. And sometimes, when my mama called me for supper, I would pretend that I wouldn't hear because I was having too much fun. And then she'd use that middle name. God gave Southerners a middle name for when they got in trouble. And when she called Daryl Lee, Huckabee, I'd better come. And I'd stand there and she'd say, boy, didn't you hear me calling you? And I looked down at my shoes and I had no answer. She sent me to go cut the switch. Well, as I was laying in bed at night during those hard times that I thought I was going to see Jesus face to face real soon, I knew that he was going to look me in the face and say, didn't you hear me call? And I had no answer. And so I decided then and there that with whatever time I had left, I was going to answer that call and I was going to preach the gospel at every opportunity. I didn't make a deal with God. I didn't say, if you'll heal me from this cancer, I'll do what you wanted me to do. I just said, I will, and I started doing that while I was still being told that I only had a few weeks left. I've gone back and become a lay minister of the United Methodist Church. I don't know if I'll ever be in a situation to be ordained as a minister, but I don't care if I'm ordained by human beings on earth, because I think I'm ordained by God to preach His word, and that's good enough for me. So one day, as Jesus was teaching so that we could know how to be in obedience to Him and find that perfect peace, the Pharisees and the teachers of the law were listening. They had come from every village of Galilee, from Judea and Jerusalem. And they were sitting there. And they had not come to be instructed. They had not come to find out how to live their lives. They had not come to be obedient to God. They had come to catch Jesus in a mistake. Lord, please deliver me from the self-righteous and the sanctimonious among us. Lord, deliver me from legalism, from the so-called religious people who are always going around with their nose in the air trying to catch somebody else in a mistake, to catch somebody else in a sin. Lord, deliver me from the people who can't see the beam in their own eye but can see the splinter in mine. If you want to follow Daryl Huckabee around trying to catch him in a sin, it won't be very hard. You don't have to be Sherlock Holmes. For I am a sinner saved by the grace of God. But the Pharisees were jealous of Jesus. They didn't like the attention that Jesus was attracting. And they were scared of Jesus because they were afraid that he was speaking the truth and he was going to take their power and their authority away from them. So they were following Jesus. They had come from Jerusalem, Judea, up to the Galilee. And they were listening to Jesus where he was teaching, trying to catch him in a mistake. And it wasn't hard. Because four friends had brought their paralyzed friend, and they were determined to lay him at the feet of Jesus. More about that in a moment. I love that story. When I was little, we didn't have much material things in our home, but we had books. And one of my favorite books was the Golden Book of Bible Stories. It was illustrated. It had beautiful pictures. And I remember the picture of those four friends lowering that mat down through the ceiling at the feet of Jesus. I love to tell those stories. said, because of your faith, your friend's sins are forgiven. And he was healed. And the Pharisees jumped on that like white on rice. Blasphemy! 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 Who do you think you are? Only God can heal sins. And Jesus said, that's right. Any other questions? Jesus was introducing the fact that the Messianic, Messianic age had come because he was revealing that he was the Messiah, because yes, only God can forgive sins. And yes, Jesus was God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus was, is, and will forevermore be God Almighty. He was God in human form. And he did have the authority to forgive sins. He does have the authority. And the Pharisees could stand this. And they began plotting at that very moment to eventually put Jesus to death, because that was blasphemy. Jesus said, what is easier? To say your sins are forgiven, or to say take up your mat? And he did that. He said that to the paralytic, and the paralytic took up his mat and went home, and everyone was amazed. Everyone was amazed at what Jesus had done. And you know, we need to get back to being amazed at what Jesus has done. Jesus is still in the miracle business. God is still in the miracle business. I don't think that we're still in the being amazed business. I don't think we take time, a lot of times, to recognize and to realize who God is and how great God is. Now, I want to go back, and the focus of today's message is not the Pharisees, and it's not the miracle, the miraculous healing, but it is on those four friends. Some men, well, let's back up at the end of chapter, verse 17, and the power of the Lord was present for him to heal the sick. The power of the Lord was present. The power of the Lord is still present. What is lacking too often is the faith of those friends who brought the man to Jesus. Faith is the most unused power source in the world today. Some men came carrying a paralytic on a mat. They tried to take him into the house and lay him. Jesus was teaching in a home, and the home was full. The doorways were jammed. We saw the houses in Capernaum last week where Jesus taught, where Jesus slept, where Jesus stayed. We saw Peter's house. The houses were built of stone, and they had straw thatched roofs. And they had steps going up beside the outside of the house so that on hot summer days, believe it or not, they didn't have air conditioning. Don't know how they got along without it. On hot days, you could go up on the roof and sleep in the cool of the evening because it was so hot. So there were steps going outside. These men wanted their friend to get to Jesus really, really bad. So they carried him up the stairs, onto the roof, and dug a hole in the roof and lowered him down at the feet of Jesus. Now let me bring up a couple of images from today. Wouldn't it be nice, number one, if our church today was so full that there were people standing in the doorways, that the pews were full, and there was no room to get anybody else in the church? Wouldn't that be wonderful? Of course, we start a building campaign right away because that's the way we do things nowadays if that happened. But nonetheless, it would be wonderful. I don't think anybody would like it if somebody went up on the roof and started tearing a hole in the roof, because there again, we'd have to start raising more money to fix it. But it would be a wonderful problem to have. People wanted to hear Jesus. People wanted to know about Jesus. People wanted to be close to Jesus. The friend's friend is paralyzed. He had an affliction. How many of us have friends with an affliction? It doesn't have to be a medical. It could be. We all probably have friends that need healing, that have physical problems. But we probably have more friends and acquaintances that have spiritual problems. Is there anybody in here today who would testify, I don't have a single friend who has a spiritual problem? All of my friends are living in obedience. They've all got it covered. Everything's good. Of course not. Of course we wouldn't. What's the greatest commandment? That you love your Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. We're supposed to love our neighbors. Do we love our neighbors enough to go out on a limb and to try to put them at the foot of Jesus? Do we? Stepping on my toes this morning, because I have a lot of friends who don't know Christ. I have a lot of friends who aren't following Christ. And I very rarely do very much to really work at getting them to the feet of Jesus. Oh, every now and then I might say, why don't you come to church with us? I might invite them to go see a religious movement. I might do some kind of little comment about what God's done for my life. But if they don't accept those hints, it's been a long time since I've gone out of my way, since I've carried somebody to the roof and cut through the roof to get them at the feet of Jesus. But if we love them, why wouldn't we do that for them? Why wouldn't we want to get them close to Jesus so that their souls could be healed, so that they could spend eternity with us? I wish I had friends like those four friends who would do whatever it took to get me to the feet of Jesus. You know, in this country today, 8% of us are in church right now. That's not very many. 8%. Now, when people do surveys, they claim 40% claim they attend church regularly, because nobody wants to admit on the survey they don't attend church. But there's a difference in the surveys and the people in the pews. And the actual percentage of people in the pews on any given Sunday morning is 8. That means that 92% of people aren't in church. 80,000 people in Rockdale County this morning. 6,000 people in church this morning. 74,000 aren't. Are any of those people your friends? Are any of those people my friends? Could we do service to anybody by bringing them to the feet of Jesus, no matter what it took. Of course we could. Well, does it help? Do our prayers for other people help? Isn't it a personal thing? Don't they have to ask for forgiveness? Certainly they do. But we know that intercessory prayer works if we're diligent and faithful. It works. I can testify to that. This is not hearsay. I like to watch court shows. I like to watch court dramas. And Perry Mason used to be my favorite. I would watch Perry Mason, and the last 5 minutes, he would always get somebody to stand up and confess in the back of the courtroom. Every single time. But you've watched those court dramas, and in court dramas, you know that if somebody says something in court that's just hearsay, it's something they've heard, the defense attorney will stand up and say, "Objection, Your Honor, that's hearsay," and the judge will say, "Objection sustained," and they'll throw it out. I'm not giving you hearsay, I'm giving you testimony. I saw, I know, I've been through it. Intercessory prayer works. When I was diagnosed with cancer, they told me that it would be simple. I had surgery, that would take care of it. It didn't. I had 210 radiation treatments, that would take care of it. It didn't. I didn't tell anybody.